Hey, what's up guys, and welcome to part 3 of my Attack on Titan chapter 138 review and discussion. Before we go any further, as always, I gotta warn you that this video is going to contain spoilers. If you haven't read the chapter, then, well, you know what I'm gonna say. Okay, let's get into it. So I have got a super interesting theory for you guys today that I'm really excited to share with you guys. And yes, we are going to talk about Mikasa, as I said before, but I've had a little change of plans because a friend of mine came up with a theory that I just thought was really fascinating. And this theory is about the worm, what it does, and its actual role within the story in the world of Attack on Titan. And the really exciting thing is that this theory might actually explain a lot of things that other theories can't, that don't really fit into other theories. Things that don't really make a lot of sense in any way. I'm talking about that flashback with Eren and Zeke and Grisha, when Eren talked him into killing the Reese family. Talking about Ymir, like the original Ymir, Ymir Fritz, why she is the way she is. Why Eren has become the way he's become. And I think this theory fits in quite well with the very popular time loop theory, so we're going to be talking about it a bit in conjunction with that. So this is going to be pretty cool. I haven't heard anybody talk about anything close to this so far, and I built a lot onto it while writing this script, so this is going to be a bit longer than the other ones, but I hope you guys enjoy. Before we get started, I gotta give credit to my friend who came up with this theory, Cole99. You might remember him. He helped me with a couple of the videos before, and he's my best AOT friend, so say hello in the comments to him. Thank him for this theory, because without him, this video would not exist. So let's talk about this worm. What is it? Where did it come from? Does it have a mind of its own? Does it have its own will, its own goals? What does it do? Why does it do it? Why does it make people into Titan? I'll explain in depth in a minute, but basically it's that this worm thing itself was actually the mechanism that caused time to flow in a sort of loop, and that it was like some sort of parasite from another world or maybe another dimension. And every time it's about to be destroyed, it resets time. So I asked him if he wanted to write a little something in his own words to help explain this theory. So I'm going to go ahead and read that first, and then I'll kind of elaborate on it a little bit because we did discuss a bit more after that, and then give my thoughts. As it turns out, there was more to Mikasa Ackerman's headaches. What I think is really going on is that it's always been that bug that's been in control. Each time it's stopped, it will start another loop, and it's been doing this for who knows how long now. Mikasa's headaches have more to do with than just being an Ackerman. We have never been told the real story of what Ackermans are truly capable of. We know a few things, like their minds cannot be erased, they have the ability to retain some form of Titan strength, but I think it runs a little deeper than that. And that bug/parasite is what is the root cause of all of it. It wasn't Ymir that said no to Zeke, that said no to the sterilization plan. No new Eldians means no new Titans, which means, you know, no more bug. Mikasa's headaches are because she can remember each time in each loop and can remember how it should have ended, or at least what would have been one of the outcomes that she would have liked to have. She now knows what needs to be done to kill this bug for the last time. For the first time in all of these loops, she's finally killed Eren. The reason we see a smile on her face is because she gets it now. She has seen past herself and sees what needs to be done for the greater good, not for her selfish reasons. And with that, she cuts his head off, ending the loop forever. The bug being in control this whole time answers everything. From Kruger knowing Armin and Mikasa's names, to giving certain memories at certain times to different Titan shifters, all in efforts to lead towards the ultimate goal of continuing to move forward, in winning and eliminating any opportunity for anyone else or anything else to destroy the bug. So, in other words, this entire story, everything that has happened in the world of Attack on Titan since the Titans have existed, has been dictated by this worm thing. So this certainly answers the question I posed in a previous video, whether it had a will of its own or not. And I think it definitely does. I mean, it pretty much showed that when it released that gas in this chapter. that turned everybody into Titans. Now, nobody knows where it came from, but it has been controlling everything from behind the scenes in an effort to eliminate everyone or anything that might threaten its existence. This is why Zeke's plan was rejected, not by Eren or Ymir, but by the worm itself. This worm-like creature is something that can transcend time and space and influence its subjects, the subjects of Ymir. The reason Eren got his father's memories, the reason Kruger said what he did to Grisha about Armin and Mikasa, and perhaps even Eren's apparent ability to influence his father's decisions by going back in time. Each Eldian is a part of this living thing, or has a part of it inside them, effectively making them an extension of its physical form. Kind of reminds me of like Genova from Final Fantasy VII almost. This would also explain the Titan powers and the paths themselves. The founding Titan is the center of control for this creature, and it uses the paths to not only influence their behavior, but to manipulate their memories, alter their physical bodies, and perhaps even allow them to travel through space and time, or at least think they are. In Mikasa's case, the Ackerman power has never been fully explained, and seeing as Ackermans were created through human experimentation, there is no telling what kinds of unexpected side effects might emerge. Perhaps that is the key to stopping this parasitic monster. Perhaps Mikasa, for whatever reason, eventually gains this ability to travel through time and space, which would explain her dream in chapter 138. Perhaps she may have even eventually gained the ability to see all of these possible outcomes, enabling her to choose the one which she felt was best. Or perhaps she has experienced this loop again and again, but is just now remembering everything she has witnessed. Since the Ackermans are the only Eldians whose memories can't be erased, with each reset, she may have forgotten the previous realities temporarily, but the worm cannot fully purge these memories from her mind, which is why she says, "See you later, Eren," because she eventually remembers this. And upon this realization, she knows it's not the end, and that everything will simply start all over again. That is also why she was smiling as well right before she killed him, because she had finally let go. She was able to finally stop being selfish, understanding that killing him was the best and only way to bring all of this to an end, something she was never able to do in the previous loops. When they talk about Eren and the Attack Titan constantly moving forward, perhaps it's this parasite that has really been driving them to do so. Mikasa was the key to finally putting a stop to this never-ending cycle. When she was able to overcome her own fear of losing Eren, she was able to overpower this creature, putting an end to its hold over the Eldian people and the world that feared and hated them. Now here's a few thoughts of my own to kind of build on my friend's theory. So this creature, we of course don't know where it came from, but based on the images we see of it and the vague explanation we get, I'm starting to believe that this creature was something that naturally evolved into this world. Something that evolved to be the ultimate survivor. It is literally life in its most determined form. It is so concerned with survival that it's developed ways to literally move molecules through space to different places in the world through these paths, which is how the Titans form. It infects and manipulates outside hosts so it can achieve this, and has even learned how to influence time. Its ultimate goal is survival. I think that really fits into this idea and the theme of the manga. The whole manga is really about survival, and I think it makes a lot of sense to just have this creature that is just doing everything it possibly can, only to make sure it continues to exist. Now, obviously, this creature is definitely very much like a parasite. Parasites naturally use other creatures as hosts to survive. meaning that the Eldians were not ever really Titans or possessed the Titan powers themselves, but their bodies were simply altered to accommodate this creature's need to survive. The Eldians are the hosts for this parasitic entity. This is really not too far away from reality either. There are a number of parasites in the natural world that are known to alter the physicality of their hosts, and in some cases, are even able to control their minds. Because of this, it is definitely possible that Aaron doesn't have full control of his decisions, and because he was the holder of the Founding Titan, was influenced by this creature to do what he did in order to ensure the parasite's survival. Perhaps this creature is literally using mind control on him, or at least altering his mind just enough to get him to do what it wants him to do. It makes me wonder, actually, if this is why King Fritz made a vow to renounce war. If it's true that the ancient Eldians were as savage and violent as they are made out to be, if this could explain why. Perhaps it was all just this creature trying to gain control over everything in its path, to give itself the best chance of survival. That would make sense with the whole Eldians taking over other nations and forcing them to, like, breed with them and stuff like that. It's trying to spread itself out across the world as much as it can, almost like a virus even. But perhaps King Fritz found out about the true nature of the Titans and realized that the violence would never stop until he did something about it, something no one else could undo. This would suggest that humans, of course, could gain some power over the creature, and that it can't actually influence every single thing they do. That makes perfect sense. Or, alternatively, this creature itself made King Fritz take this vow because it felt like it was in danger. Perhaps it believed that its enemies were growing too strong and were going to overpower it. So it retreated to the island and made King Fritz issue this threat in order to protect itself. The Titans outside the walls, the Rhys family secrets, the inheriting of the Founding Titan over and over again, all these systems were put into place for one reason, to ensure the survival of this creature. That would be pretty crazy, but I actually think the former is probably more likely. But if the creature's ultimate goal is to survive, then why would the Eldian tribes start fighting against one another? Well, I guess the simplest answer would be that, as I proposed before, the worm doesn't actually possess full control over its subjects, which I think we see plenty of evidence of. That has to be the case. Otherwise, you know, we would have no characters. It would just be the bug. But anyway, the subjects of Ymir still retain autonomy, of course, but the creature can influence people by showing them certain memories and visions from other people, other points in time, or even other potential universes, whether they actually exist or not. Maybe it can even show people their dreams, their desires, what they wish things would be like. I think it's safe to say it certainly can influence people's memories. If the Founding Titan can do it, then this worm certainly can, because the Founding Titan really is, they're kind of one and the same. Specifically in Aaron's case, however, I think his situation is a little more unique. I think it might be possible that the creature has a lot more control over him than it can gain over other people, just because he has the Founding Titan. Especially if he is the first person to have possession of the Founding Titan who isn't a Fritz, which I'm assuming he is. I don't know if this has ever happened before, where someone who wasn't part of the royal family got a hold of the Titan. I don't think so. We've never gotten any hints to that ever happening. So this might make Aaron particularly vulnerable to being more directly influenced or controlled by this creature, and less able to fight back. I'm still kind of up in the air whether Aaron's decisions were all his own, if that makes sense, or if he is being controlled by something. Like, I feel like there's evidence for either case, but anyway. In fact, thinking about it now, this might explain Mikasa's vision in this chapter. Maybe this wasn't her traveling to an alternate universe as I had originally thought. maybe this memory or vision is being placed in her mind by the worm, the parasite, in an attempt to stop her from killing Eren. Perhaps this is the creature trying to influence Mikasa by reminding her of her feelings for him. When Eren asks Mikasa to forget about him after he dies, perhaps it's trying to use some kind of reverse psychology thing on her or something, causing her to be more likely to reject the plan to kill him by posing a scenario that's actually encouraging her to accept this. But it has the opposite effect, ironically. She knows deep down, at least she strongly believes, that this is not really Eren. And maybe she's right, that Eren would never have wanted this, never would have agreed to this, never would have done this in a million years, that it was never him really making these decisions, that the real Eren, trapped inside, wanted to be stopped. He wants her to kill him, to end this, as it is the only way to stop the rumbling, because, as I've said before in previous videos, Eren hates when people die. Like, Eren, he's always so sad throughout the whole story, anytime anybody died. So to just pull this 180 like this, I mean, on one hand, yeah, things happen, people change their point of view, their mindset, but it's just so extreme, you know? And Eren, he's got some anger issues, he's definitely... the whole, like, killing those two dudes when he was just a kid, very questionable, but... like, it's shown us over and over again through this story that Eren is a genuinely good person. Like, he genuinely cares about people. He wants to do good in the world. And to end up just turning around and destroying it, it really just doesn't make any sense. And this person that he's become, it just doesn't feel like the same character. I know Isayama's kind of trying to show and explain how he's changed and why he's changed, but still, like, I don't know. I don't know if I'm totally convinced. I would be very happy to find out that this is not what Eren, like, really wanted to do. I would be much less sad about what has happened to him if that turns out being the case. But anyway, when Mikasa puts on the scarf in this scene, after he tells her to forget about him, she is rejecting this false version of Eren. She refuses to forget about him. She refuses to forget who he was to her before all of this happened. Knowing deep down that the person she had taken the scarf off for was never really him. That when she felt a separation from him, it wasn't because he had actually changed. He had actually become someone else. Someone else, or something else, was controlling him. So she puts the scarf back on in honor of his memory, who he really is, and does what she feels in her heart is right, knowing that this is what the real Eren, the Eren that she fell in love with, would have wanted. This would also explain why Eren was smiling at her right before she killed him. Because by doing so, Mikasa was actually setting Eren free. He was no longer himself. Eren had become a slave to this creature that had seized control of his mind in order to ensure its own survival. A slave that wrought violence and death across the world. Something the true Eren would have never wanted to become. Just imagine being trapped in this body, doing these things that are so far removed from how you actually feel and who you actually are. And here's a few more thoughts for you. And one of the main reasons I think this theory could really hold water. Everyone seems to agree that in order to stop the loop, Mikasa must kill Eren. But why? Why does this specifically have to happen in order to break the cycle? How does Eren dying and Mikasa's acceptance of his death bring about this outcome? Here's my theory to answer this question. If the parasite has been resetting time, say every time someone attempts to kill or destroy it, then trying to do that won't actually work. You try to kill it, it's just gonna reset everything again. Most of the characters aren't aware of this, but have realized that this creature is extremely strong and practically unkillable. The fact that this thing was apparently trapped in a tree suggests that it's Hexus. Okay, back to being serious. What it suggests is that it may have been trapped there, either by natural circumstances or by people who realized they couldn't kill it, but had to contain it somehow. Whatever the case, it seems to have been lying dormant in this tree for who knows how long. And because it is a parasite, or at least seems to be, perhaps this creature can't actually use any of its abilities, including being able to reset time, unless it has a living host. Emphasis on the living part. Something connecting it to the rest of the natural world and to its subjects. Perhaps in all this time, since it attached itself to Ymir, it has never been seen or discovered by humans. It's just been kind of hiding inside the Titans and the Eldians' bodies unnoticed. As it was passed down in the form of the Founding Titan, through the Fritz family, and spread throughout the Eldian race. No one ever really knew of its existence, so all this time, it remained in hiding, manipulating the Eldians and their impact on the world in secret. Because it was always attached to a host, it was never able to be stopped before, because in each cycle, if we presume Eren has tried to break this loop multiple times, he was never able to actually detach it from its host. Now, the fact that the consciousness or spirit of previous shifters seem to remain within the paths is interesting too, and suggests to me that this creature kind of absorbs the life or the consciousness or the spirit, if you will, of these shifters. That is why Ymir, although she died, remained within this creature all this time. And maybe that explains Ymir's curse as well, the 13-year time limit, because this parasite is slowly sucking away the life of its hosts. And while it suggests that Ymir herself was in control of the Founding Titan and its power, this may only be partially true. As the first host, Ymir was unique, and perhaps because of her weak will, her belief that she was and will always be no more than a slave, the creature used this to its advantage, forcing her to do all the work of creating these titans for it, like when we see her building them with sand in the paths, instead of having to do it itself. I guess you gotta make them some way, right? After all, something must have been telling her what to do during all this time, that she didn't have another human being ordering her around. Because her whole thing is, she just takes orders up until the moment Eren told her that she didn't have to do that anymore. Even when we first see her, she looks dirty and worn, like she's just been working her ass off for a literal eternity. Or at least around like 2,000 years, I guess. So if it's true that this worm, this parasite, can't actually be killed without causing a reset and starting a new loop all over again, obviously they have to find a different way to stop it. But if we theorize that this creature can't use any of its abilities unless it has a host, because it's a parasite, if Eren were to create a scenario where he's able to separate the centipede creature from its living host himself, then he could open up this possibility for someone to either kill it or trap it while it's unable to actually reset time like it has so many times before. So by doing all of this stuff, creating this specific scenario, Eren has succeeded in separating the worm from not only himself, but Ymir and the Founding Titan as well, theoretically leaving it powerless and giving everyone else a chance to destroy it without setting off a new time loop. Eren presumably being the one person who found out about the loop in all these resets was the only person who could make this happen. He tried over and over to stop the cycle in various ways, but until now has always failed. Eventually, he realized he had to put himself in a position where he, possessing the Founding Titan, would have to force someone to kill him. And they couldn't just kill him with like a sword or something like that either. They had to attack him with enough brute force to actually physically separate the worm from his body. So he needed something like an explosion that would not only separate this creature from him, but also be able to move it a distance away from him so it can't immediately reattach. This is why he had to perform such violent acts. This is why he had to use the rumbling. He had to provoke people, whether it be the Survey Corps, which I think he kind of knew they would come after him, the Marley, or someone else, to use a lot of power, like an explosion, which of course they would do because of this massive attack he was undertaking, in order to achieve this. He himself couldn't do it, nor could he tell anyone of his plan, because if he did, this would have tipped off the worm, it would have found out, and it may have tried to stop him. He had to put on an act, pretending he was doing all of this to protect Eldia, and thus the worm, in order to get to this point. This would explain the scene too, where he was trying to get Armin and Mikasa to hate him, because he needed to make them more likely to kill or allow him to be killed, and not be so protective. And yeah, basically just to be clear, because I'm not sure if I'm being specific enough, the creature becoming detached from its hosts disrupts its connection with the host and everything connected to that host through the paths. So it can't actually influence or control anyone in that state. And it also inhibits its ability to manipulate time. It's not until the main host, Eren in this case, is actually killed that it's completely severed from all of these connections, because it no longer has a connection to its hosts. It no longer has a connection to the paths, and thus no longer has a connection to all the humans, all the Eldians, that are connected by these paths. Think of it like the worm, while its host is alive, even if it's detached, the parts of the worm that are in the Titans, that are in the Shifters, that give them these abilities, are still living. But they're living through the actual host, not the worm itself. So when the host dies, all of those connections, all those pieces of this parasite, die as well. That would mean that the Titan Shifter's abilities will be taken away. Everybody who's in their Shifter form right now will turn back into a human, and hopefully their lifespan will be restored, so they don't only have however many years they have left. Ymir's curse will be gone, and their lives won't be cut short anymore. And hopefully that also means that these newly created pure Titans, including Jean, Connie, and Gabby, will be turned back into their normal human form as well. Additionally, all Eldians will no longer be able to actually turn into Titan. They will no longer be connected to this creature that makes that possible. They'll just be normal people again. It may also be that the Ackermans, Levi and Mikasa, will lose their special Titan experimentation-induced abilities as well. But I'm not so sure. They might actually retain their power, since they are a result of human experimentation rather than having a natural connection with this parasite. So yeah, I don't know. I don't have all the answers, obviously. But my hope though, I really hope that Isayama will finally amend Armin's criminally underutilized character and have him come up with some kind of genius plan to stop this thing, now that Eren has given them the optimal opportunity to do so. Alright guys, well once again, big thanks to Cole99 for letting me talk about his theory in this video and helping me write the script. If you enjoyed this video, give it a like, subscribe, hit that notification bell, and if you like these kinds of long, in-depth discussion videos about Attack on Titan, check out some more of my content. Attack on Titan's almost over, so now's the time to do it. Alright guys, thanks again for watching, as always, and I'll see you in the next video. Peace. Stop trying to grab me. Am I gonna die? Oh my god, getting the frick out of here. Let's take one of these real quick. That was it then. I just turn around and there's another Titan freak coming at me. Oh my god. And yeah, okay. Jesus Christ. Oh, Armin. You are no Mikasa, that's for sure. But I still love you! Yeah, okay, need gas. Need gas, story of my life, need gas. More gas. God, what is... splat? What's the sound effect make? Splat. Like, I'm not even cutting, I'm just splatting. Just splatting on them. These guys are hard. Is it dead already? I mean, is it dead yet? Already. Is it dead yet? Oh, what a face. What a face. Okay, last one, I think. Let's go. Okay. Oh, no. Wow, of course. Of course. Don't look at me with those derpy eyes. You freaking dumb Titan.